Dear colleagues, good morning. I am Antonella Giannantoni from Italy, and I would like to present the results of the following study, Onabotulinum toxin A versus Incobotulinum toxin A in the treatment of idiopathic and neurogenic detrusor overactivity. These are my disclosures. I would like to start with this consideration that following onabotulinum toxin A intradetrusor injection in both idiopathic and neurogenic detrusor overactivity patients, the following observations have been reported. First of all, a large intra-individual variability and loss of response along repeat treatments, then rates of failure, which are high, as in up 40% of cases, and also high rates of urinary tract infections and bacteriuria. Thus, I think that having alternative botulinum toxin for the mentioned indications would be highly warranted. We know that another botulinum toxin A exists. It is commercially available and it is a German product, named Incobotulinum toxin A, which was approved by the FDA in 2011 for the treatment of cervical dystonia and blepharospasm, and in 2015 for upper limb spasticity in adults. But currently, very few information exists about the use, the efficacy, and safety of Incobotulinum toxin in the urologic field. Thus, we aimed to compare the efficacy and safety of these two neurotoxins in patients affected by urinary incontinence due to idiopathic detrusor overactivity or neurogenic detrusor overactivity with urinary incontinence in the short-term follow-up. This is a national multicenter prospective randomized study which included naive patients for botulinum toxin A affected by IDO or NDO with urinary incontinence. And these patients underwent a baseline evaluation, which included a 3-day voiding diary, urinalysis and culture, urodynamics, the visual analog scale to score the impact of urinary symptoms on quality of life. Neurogenic detrusor overactivity patients had to be affected by spinal cord injury or multiple sclerosis, and the whole had to be under intermittent catheterization. And these patients were randomized 1-to-1 to receive intradetrusor injections of onabotulinum toxin type A or incobotulinum toxin type A. The treatment dosages were 100 units for IDO, and 200 units for NDO. The follow-up was performed at 8 weeks follow-up with the same evaluation as performed at baseline. 54 patients were included and treated, 28 underwent onabotulinum toxin type A intradetrusor administration, and 26 to incobotulinum toxin type A. Looking at this table, you can observe that all the considered parameters, which were daytime urinary frequency, nighttime urinary frequency, urinary incontinence episodes, daily frequency, the VAS scores, and incontinence quality of life scores, did not significantly differ between the two groups of treatment at baseline. At 8 weeks follow-up, we could observe a significant improvement in all the considered items, in all the considered clinical parameters, without any significant difference between incobotulinum toxin type A and onabotulinum toxin type A, except for nocturia. Indeed, nocturia significantly decreased, particularly in patients who were affected by idiopathic detrusor overactivity and treated in the group of incobotulinum toxin type A. These beneficial effects were observed within 2 weeks after the injection in both groups of patients, and they persisted along the whole follow-up period, and no risk amount of adverse effects was observed with the new compound, which was incobotulinum toxin. If we consider in details the side effects, we can observe that at eight weeks follow-up, UTIs, bacteriuria, dysuria and PVR were observed in both groups of treatment, but particularly if we consider the frequency of UTIs and bacteriuria, this was lower in patients who were treated with incobotulinum toxin type A, although this difference was not significant between the two groups of treatment. We have to say that onabotulinum toxin currently represents a standard, effective and safe minimal invasive treatment for refractory IDO and NDO in adults, with medium success rates ranging from 60 to 80%, but with the not negligible primary and secondary failures rates. And contrary to onabota, incobotulinum toxin A is free from complexin proteins, which are hemagglutinins and non-toxin non-hemagglutinins, which are not required, indeed, for the pharmacological activity. And although these complexin proteins in the formulation of onabota A have been considered for a long time as a passive bystanders, now we have a clear evidences of a significant response in a human neuronal cells induced by these proteins with an increased release of inflammatory cytokines. I can conclude by saying that incobotulinum toxin intradecreaser injections are not inferior to onabotulinum toxin A in improving urinary symptoms and quality of life in patients with IDO and NDO with urinary incontinence in the short-term follow-up, in these preliminary results. But these are preliminary results. I think that the lower frequency of UTIs and bacteriuria in patients treated with incobotulinum toxin deserves further investigation, because I think that it could be hypothesized that this effect is due to its different pharmacological properties and probably to a limited ability to induce an inflammatory response in the ejected tissues. But the number of patients in this study is too limited, and this result was not significant. Then I want also to add that low absent risk of immunogenicity of incobotulinum toxin A, as observed in immunological testing studies conducted in both blepharospasm and cervical dystonia, but also in spasticity, probably are really useful in the urologic field, because these patients, particularly those affected by neurogenic disease, often require multiple injections to treat multiple different organ dysfunction. Thus, I want to finish here, and I want to thank you for your attention.